recipient, James Ogden III.
I didn't think to get that out earlier, so. I'm deeply honored to be the recipient of the Nevins-Freeman Award for this year, to have my name appear on a list of historians recognized by an award named for two of the historians who did so much to advance scholarship and knowledge of this watershed era in our nation's development. It is an honor to appear on a list of recipients that includes such influential historians as Bruce Catton, Bud Robertson, John Hope Franklin, my former boss, Bob Krick, Jim McPherson, and the much-missed Jerry Russell, Will Green, the incomparable Colonel Bars, and Bruce Allardyce, and Rob, and Larry Hewitt, who I understand couldn't be here this evening. I'm just as deeply honored to think that my contributions, whatever and however small they have been, are, and hopefully still will be, are considered worthy in any fashion sufficient to be recognized by the presentation of the Nevins-Freeman Award. I thank you all for the honor, and I thank you all for yet another generous contribution to battlefield preservation causes. This roundtable has been one of the greatest champions of battlefield preservation amongst all of the roundtables, and it is certainly recognized in that regard. The Civil War Roundtable of Chicago's support, both financially and by advocacy, have themselves made significant contributions to Civil War battlefield and historical preservation. And thereby, as I believe, the scholarship of the era itself. This organization not only has been an advocate for and contributed to the preservation of Reed's Bridge, which I'll talk a little bit about later on, but I have told the story quite a few times from your visit to Chattanooga in 1996, and in particular, going up to the top of Orchard Knob on the Chattanooga battlefield, which at that time was not in very good condition, and it was very gratifying to see National Military Park management respond to a letter sent by the Civil War Roundtable of Chicago to National Park Service management, of course, appropriately CCing the Illinois congressional delegation. And now when you visit Orchard Knob, it is one of the key points on that battlefield. And if you have just a short time to make a visit to Chattanooga, it's the place to go for your ability to look towards the city and Lookout Mountain and Missionary Ridge itself. And not to give too much away here, but you all have preservation in so many ways over the years. But right now, hopefully everything is still progressing appropriately. And we hope to hear in early 2015 that Civil War Trust has successfully preserved another part of the Chattanooga battlefield, a part of the Chattanooga battlefields which frustrated this group in both 1996 and 2012 relative to a potential visit. Anybody want to maybe take a guess? Brown's Ferry. It ain't a done deal yet, but everything looks promising, and hopefully in early 2015, we will hear the good news that a piece of the Browns Ferry landing has actually come into to conservation hands. So I have the privilege to work at the creation of some of the first Civil War preservationists and scholars, working at Chickamauga and Chattanooga National Military Park, an entity that was created by the very men who hallowed that ground and who were indeed, in many ways, the very first Civil War battlefield preservationists and also scholars. Preservation and study, if not true scholarship, are in the guiding legislation, the enabling legislation. Those first preservationists that got adopted in or by the Congress in 1890 when the veterans had the National Military Park created as the first such in our nation's history. As we heard in the quiz, you might challenge whether or not Chickamauga and Chattanooga National Military Park is any longer the largest Civil War battlefield park, but we still certainly are the first. But that enabling legislation, for the purpose of preserving and suitably marking for historical and professional military study the fields of some of the most remarkable maneuvers and most brilliant fighting in the War of the Rebellion, preserved for historical and professional military study, preservation, study, scholarship, study on the ground, study of the fields of some of the most remarkable maneuvers and most brilliant fighting in the war. Study on the ground hallowed now a century and a half ago in the struggle over the very meaning and existence of our nation. The veterans had codified in this act of 1890 essentially the admonition of one of their by then dead combatant comrades of 27 years earlier. Many of you all will recognize this quote. The scene now presented was unspeakably grand, the resolute and impetuous charge, the rush of our heavy columns sweeping out of the shadow and gloom of the forest into the open fields flooded with sunlight, the glitter of arms, the onward dash of artillery and mounted men, the retreat of the foe, the shouts of the host of our army, the dust, the smoke, the noise of firearms, of whistling balls and grapeshot, and of bursting shell, made up a battle scene of unsurpassed grandeur. Here General Hood gave to me the last order I received to him or from him on the field: go ahead and keep ahead of everything. That quote, of course, comes from this gentleman, Bushrod Russ Johnson, the Ohio and Quaker-born commander of a provisional division within Braxton Bragg's Army of Tennessee, the division that by happenstance wound up in the front line of Longstreet's formation on September the 20th, and which poured through that gap opened in the Union line by the moving of Thomas J. Wood's division. But Johnson, as he wrote that quote, many of you all have heard that read to you on the battlefield itself. Johnson was conscious that the unsurpassing grandeur, the horror, the resolute and impetuous charge, the simplicity of John Bell Hood's order of go ahead and keep ahead of everything, that all of those things might obscure the real intricacies of the moment and the true battle, the role and experience of individuals in it. And Johnson went on in that quote to admonish those of his and future generations. How this order was obeyed will be determined by those who investigate all the details of this battle. Best determined by those who investigate all the details of this battle. An admonition for investigation, inquiry, study, scholarship. This roundtable, by its advocacy and support of preservation and scholarship, has helped achieve Johnson's admonition as well. One of those projects associated with Chickamauga and Chattanooga National Military Park is the Reed's Bridge Preservation undertaken by Civil War Trust. Hopefully all of you all in this room this evening are aware that over the last couple of years, Civil War Trust has successfully negotiated for and closed on two parcels of land at Reed's Bridge totaling 107 acres. A smaller smaller parcel on the east side of Chickamauga Creek, and a larger parcel of a little over 100 acres on the west side of Chickamauga Creek. Hopefully, beginning in 2015, Civil War Trust will begin working on developing visitor access to that property. There are a number of issues that have to be resolved, an existing hay lease on the larger property. And there's a former machine shop building on the smaller eastern portion, and some other issues. But hopefully in 2015 and soon thereafter, they'll begin to provide public access to that property, just as Civil War Trust has done on other properties that they have preserved at other battlefields. Not only will this project of Civil War Trust restore and open some more of the Chickamauga hallowed ground, but it should also encourage and will certainly help facilitate, for those so inclined, the further fulfillment of Bushrod Johnson's admonition to investigate all the details of this battle. In this case, the fight at Chickamauga's Reed's Bridge. Reed's Bridge first appears in a substantive way in the Chickamauga story on the hot late summer afternoon of Friday, September 11, 1863, as the much-reduced 1st Division of the 21st Corps of the Army of the Cumberland marched through the then seemingly inescapable heat and dust, dust that grew worse day by day in that drought year of 1862-1863, and that grew worse day by day in the environs of Chattanooga, as now two large armies maneuvered in search of advantage and victory. Dust that on the main roads was consistently described by participants as ankle or shoe mouth deep. A result of the then just dirt surfaces of even the best roads in the Chattanooga region being ground ever finer by the tramp and tread of tens of thousands of feet and hooves and tires of wheeled vehicles, but then only to be driven into the air in choking but telltale volumes by those same passing troops. This much-reduced 1st Division, 21st Corps force, really just a single brigade, George Buell's Illinois, Indiana, Michigan, and Ohio 1st Brigade of the 1st Division. The 1st Division commander, Thomas J. Wood, and his staff, and part of the division train. Wood's other two brigades at that time were both on detached duty by orders from higher headquarters. This reduced 1st Division was moving as best as the rough country roads, as Thomas J. Wood would write, allowed in execution of the as quickly as possible directive in the 3:30 p.m. orders from Army headquarters to 21st Corps and 1st Division Commander Wood, that were in many ways the first of William Stark Rosecrans' order for consolidation as a result of the enemy threat manifested over the last 2 days in front of George Thomas's 14th Corps in McLemore's Cove. As Wood and Buell's men came down into the valley of West Chickamauga Creek en route to the area where the Chattanooga and Lafayette Road crossed the that sluggish stream at Lee and Gordon's Mill, and where they would join one of Wood's other detached brigades, Charlie Parker's mostly Ohio brigade, Wood's men found on the east side of the Chickamauga the evidence of where an enemy force of cavalry had been camped. There was the debris of uneaten forage scattered about, and the dung from large numbers of horses. Based on the amount and spacing of that evidence, there had been multiple units camped there, perhaps five. Interviews with area citizens gained the intelligence that it had been five regiments, and the Confederate cavalry commander Nathan Bedford Forrest had been there himself. More evidence, perhaps, counter to what 21st Corps Commander Tom Crittenden believed, more evidence that Confederates were indeed present in large numbers, and that while they had retreated out of Chattanooga, they might not any longer be retreating too far into Georgia. Just beyond the evidence of the encampment on the farm of then Confederate soldier James Jasper Reed and his father Jacob, Wood and Buell found that the bridge, and here's the home of James Jasper Reed and his father Jacob Reed. This was an image taken in 1895 at the time of the dedication of the National Military Park. And standing in the doorway is James Jasper Reed and his wife. This structure survived into to the 20th century, and one of the Reed descendants is still alive today, now at 92 years of age. She was born in that house in the 1920s. The house survived until about 1940. Wood and Buell found that the bridge that they hoped to use to cross the snaking, sluggish, but extremely steep and rocky bank to Chickamauga had been disabled. The rebel cavalry that had been camped in the area had thrown the flooring off the one-lane wooden structure that crossed the creek there, and that because it did so on the Reed Farm, was known as Reed's Bridge. This is an 1890s image of Reed's Bridge, and this one as well. And as you look carefully at these three images, you can see some of the shoring that was necessary to keep this bridge standing over the creek. By soldier accounts, the bridge that was here in 1863 was very similar, if not almost entirely identical, to the one that was there in the 1890s. Maybe the 1890s bridge a little more massive in some of its timbers and structure, but still described as just a wooden trestled style bridge. Wood and Buell's column were detained for some time reflooring the bridge with planking and fence rails gathered in the area. Wood and Buell's men, once the bridge was refloored, crossed the creek and made it to the Chattanooga and Lafayette Road, and Lee and Gordon's mill and Harper's Brigade by 8 p.m. Reed's Bridge comes more fully into the story of Chickamauga when, on September 15th and 16th, 1863, Braxton Bragg, who a week earlier had been forced into abandoning the city of Chattanooga as a result of William Stark Rosecrans' broad front, multiple column advance, and who then had missed two opportunities to potentially strike with advantage at Rosecrans' army while it was still widely scattered, first in McLemore's Cove on September 10th and 11th, and then near Lee and Gordon's Mill on September the 13th. Reed's Bridge becomes more fully part of the story when, on September 15th and 16th, Braxton Bragg decided that he still potentially had an opportunity to strike at Rosecrans before Rosecrans could get the elements of his army back together again and positioned to protect newly won but only lightly garrisoned Chattanooga. Bragg increasingly realized on September the 14th, 15th, and 16th that there was a space of roughly 14 miles between Rosecrans' left at Lee and Gordon's Mill and the city of Chattanooga, and that in this 14-mile gap, there were few Union troops. And Bragg increasingly came to believe that if he could move quickly enough, that he could potentially swing into that space between Rosecrans and Chattanooga, and then attack Rosecrans when Rosecrans had the wall of Lookout Mountain still at his rear. But typical of Bragg's command style, he was slow and tentative in committing to this developing concept. Particularly, he was slow and tentative with the increasingly bulky and slow, if at all, to respond machine that was his Army of Tennessee. On September the 16th, he issued the first of the orders that will eventually lead to the Battle of Chickamauga. These orders issued that day as part of a larger special order are very tentative. It tells the Army to move, but where in there do you find a clear directive for an attack? There's no real order to strike. And this is despite the fact that on that same day, Braxton Bragg had issued a general order to be read to the men. And indeed it was, beginning on the afternoon of the 16th and continuing through the 17th. That general order in part read, "The troops will be held ready for an immediate move against the enemy. His demonstration on our flank has been thwarted, and twice has he retired before us when offered battle. We must now force him to the issue. Soldiers, you are largely reinforced. You must now seek the contest. In so doing, I know you will be content to suffer privations and encounter hardships. Your generals will lead you. You have but to respond to assure us a glorious triumph over an insolent foe. I know what your response will be." But in this first order, right, Reed's Bridge is identified. In that paragraph number 11, Reed's Bridge, Byram's Ford, Alexander's Bridge, and the fords next above will be seized and held by the cavalry. Bragg will soon after issuing this order, will decide to postpone any execution of this plan, in part because he'd received word of additional reinforcements soon to arrive for his army. Of course, one of the things that this additional preservation and this encouragement to look more broadly at some of the issues of the Battle of Chickamauga will allow you to do also is to raise such questions as whether or not this postponement by Braxton Bragg was smart. By waiting another day, how many more of the reinforcements coming to his army from Mississippi and now Virginia are going to reach his army? But by postponing that day, how many more miles distance are Rosecrans' troops going to be able to cover as they move to consolidate? On September the 17th, Braxton Bragg decided to go or to launch the offensive. And he issued a new order late on the 17th and early on the 18th. This order is more aggressive in tenor, but it is still a relatively tentative one. But late on September the 17th, Braxton Bragg actually began some pre-positioning of his troops, pre-staging the units for this move of September the 18th. But as those troops began to march in that late afternoon of the 17th, what did Union observers on Lookout Mountain and Missionary Ridge and other high points see off first to the south and then increasingly moving northward? The columns of dust, that dust on the roads now being driven into the air, potentially tipping off the enemy of what is about to happen. In the pre-dawn hours of September the 18th, Bragg more fully commits to this concept of swinging into the space between the Union left and Chattanooga. And about dawn of the 18th, he issues new orders. A circular begins to be distributed to his subordinate commands soon after daylight on September the 18th. While not as clearly stated as necessary for his bulky, slowly responsive machine. And as events will show, a reading of these orders with the offensive and with and to Bragg's benefit, he does indeed intend by this order an attack on the Union left. And here, not sure it's standing out as well as I had hoped. I've put in bold a number of the key phrases of this order. Sweep up the Chickamauga. Push vigorously on the enemy's flank and rear. Press the enemy up the stream. Join in the attack wherever the enemy may be. He will attack them in flank. The above movement will be executed with the utmost promptness, vigor, and persistence. All evidence that Bragg intended to launch an attack, assuming that he could get cooperation from his often less than initiative-minded subordinates. Graphically, what Bragg is envisioning is an effort to turn this this Union left flank. And here we have one of Dave Powell's maps of Chickamauga maps to help illustrate this. Dave's own study of Chickamauga has been inspired by the preservation of the battlefield, at least in part, and by that very admonition of Bushrod Johnson to investigate all the details of the battle. And not only do we now have from Dave his maps of Chickamauga book and Failure in the Saddle, but some of you all are beginning to see the first of his volumes on the campaign and battle itself. In this graphic, Bragg is intending for the troops of Daniel Harvey Hill and Leon and his pole to confront Union troops along Chickamauga Creek, upstream or to the south of Leon Gordon's Mill, while the troops of Simon Oliver Buckner, William Henry Talbot Shot House Walker, and eventually Bushrod Johnson and some of David Pepper Forrest's troops cross Chickamauga Creek downstream or to the north northeast of Leon Gordon's Mill, and then swing westward and southward to strike the left flank of Rosecrans' army in the area of Leon Gordon's Mill. Although it can be argued that this order was not issued until the 11th hour, a thorough reading of it clearly does show Bragg's aggressive intent. It also shows that Reed's Bridge has become more critical in the potential execution of this plan. But the crossing at or near Reed's Bridge, as identified in the order, would not be as easy even as Wood and Buell's reconstructive passage had been a week earlier. Bragg, now on September the 18th, was likely to have to do more to cross the creek at that point than the replanking that Wood and Buell had experienced on September the 11th. For now, by the 18th, Reed's Bridge was defended. Crossing by this time is defended by the small brigade of Union cavalry under Robert H.G. Minty, the son of a British Army officer who was duty stationed at that time in Ireland. And it was in Ireland that Robert Minty was born. Minty, as we heard in the quiz, will himself have a few years' service in the British Army before coming to the United States. He'll have assignments with the 2nd and 3rd Michigan Cavalry, but in the summer of 1862, will organize the 4th Michigan Cavalry and take it into the field. Soon thereafter, rise to brigade command. His small brigade at this time in September of 1863 is made up of not only his own regiment, the 4th Michigan Cavalry, but also the 7th Pennsylvania Cavalry and the 4th United States Cavalry. It also, as another one of the quiz questions, it also includes two guns, one section of the Chicago Board of Trade Battery. That battery was organized with the support and direction of the Chicago Board of Trade. And many of you, probably all of you all in this room know that as one of the recruitment incentives for the battery, the Board of Trade bought a plot in the new Chicago Cemetery, Rose Hill, to have a place to inter those members of the battery who might die in service. By the summer of 1862, tens of thousands of soldiers had died of disease in the camps and they lay buried far from home. And as what they thought was one of the incentives for recruitment would be a place nearby where those bodies could be reinterred. Today, this monument stands in that plot there at Rose Hill. The Minty's Brigade also included another regiment, or at least part of a regiment, one battalion of the 3rd Indiana Cavalry, but they were detached on September the 18th. They had been assigned to provide a cavalry screen for the small Union garrison that was then occupying the city of Chattanooga. In the campaign for Chattanooga to this point, Minty's small brigade had screened Rosecrans far left in the initial advance. He had come out of Middle Tennessee, crossed the Cumberland Mountains, the Sequatchie River Valley, the Walton's Ridge Range, and come down to the banks of the Tennessee River, well upstream of Chattanooga. He had actually had contact with Ambrose Burnside's small Union force, which was operating out of central Kentucky against Knoxville. But with the Confederate abandonment of Chattanooga, Minty's brigade is pulled down southward, ever closer to Chattanooga, and then across the Tennessee River, and assigned on September the 13th to Tom Crittenden's 21st Corps, then the left of Rosecrans' force now in North Georgia. On September the 15th, Crittenden is going to send Minty's brigade to Reed's, or the area of Reed's Bridge. Minty's men will ride to that point, push eastward over the Peavine Ridge initially, but their primary role or mission is to screen and scout in that 14-mile space between the Union left at Lee and Gordon's Mill and the city of Chattanooga. Minty will immediately begin doing this upon his arrival in the Chickamauga and Peavine Creek valleys, sending patrols southward towards Leech Tanyard, eastward towards Ringgold, and northeastward towards Graysville. And as those patrols went out, they made contact with Confederate forces. As a result of this contact, Minty begins to gain intelligence about the strength, location, and identity of Confederate troops out in front, which he dutifully reports to an unbelieving Tom Crittenden. After one of Minty's reports, Crittenden will have his chief of staff, Captain Oldershaw, respond with this language: "The Major General commanding directs me to acknowledge the receipt of your report of this date, informing him that Forrest is at Ringgold, Longstreet at Dalton, Pegram at Leeds, and Buckner at Rock Spring. All of this would indicate infantry, which the Major General commanding cannot believe. Crittenden clearly was seeing things through rose-colored or maybe Crittenden-colored glasses at this time. So, Minty will continue this patrolling out to the northeast, east, and southeast from the Reeds Bridge area on September the 16th and 17th, gaining more intelligence on the 17th. One of his patrols actually crossed the path of a Confederate infantry column that was marching in the 4th United States Cavalry, suffered a couple of casualties, and Crittenden said, oh, it couldn't be anything more than some dismounted Confederate cavalry. But dutifully on the morning of September the 18th, Minty once again began his mission of scouting and screening at 6 a.m. that morning, sending a 100-man patrol of the 4th United States Cavalry southward towards Leeds Tanyard, and another 100 men drawn from both the 4th Michigan and the 7th Pennsylvania towards Ringgold. And soon thereafter, those patrols will report back by about 7 a.m. that enemy forces are in their front, and not only are they present, they are now this day advancing towards Minty in the area of Reeds Bridge. Now, this force that Minty's men has contacted on the morning of September the 18th is commanded by Bushrod Russ Johnson. Johnson had been, until just a couple of days before, only a brigade commander within a division, within a corps, within Bragg's army. But having been detached from Alexander Peter Stewart's division to screen the withdrawal of Bragg's army southward into Georgia, particularly along the line of the Western Atlantic Railroad, Bushrod Johnson, a Bragg friend, had wound up along the Western Atlantic Railroad, which is the route by which these reinforcements from Mississippi and Virginia are arriving. And increasingly, on September the 15th, 16th, and 17th, first one and then another brigade from both Mississippi and Virginia begins to arrive along the Western Atlantic Railroad just south of Ringgold in the area of Catoosa Platform or Greenwood Station. And increasingly there is not just one brigade, but a second, a third, a fourth, eventually by the morning of September the 18th, there are six Confederate brigades along the railroad just south of Ringgold. And with this, on the morning of the 18th, Bushrod Johnson began to march the troops that have been assigned to his command, his own brigade now under John Fulton, also Evander McNair's Arkansas Brigade coming from Mississippi, a mostly Tennessee brigade under John Gregg, which has a few Texans in it for seasoning. Johnson begins to march this force under the last orders he had received from Ringgold southwestward towards Leeds to move in behind Walker and Buckner's troops. But after having marched a little less than 3 miles that morning, he received new orders from Braxton Bragg. He was redirected. Instead of marching southwestward, he was to turn and march westward towards Reeds Bridge on Chickamauga Creek. He will countermarch, actually halting the column, turning it all around, marching it back so that still his old brigade, now under John Fulton, is in front. But then once returning to Ringgold, will start moving westward on the Reeves Bridge Road. He is informed that Nathan Bedford Forrest will screen his right flank and his advance. Of course, one of the questions you can raise is, what is Forrest going to screen him with? Forrest Command is spread out over a very large area by Bragg's orders, but Johnson dutifully follows Bragg's directive and begins marching westward towards Reed's Bridge. Soon after starting in this new direction, he received a copy of that circular order that we looked at just a few minutes ago, where he learned that his column, and in parentheses, Hood's, indicating that Bragg was aware that John Bell Hood would soon arrive, that they were to cross Chickamauga Creek at or near Reed's Bridge and then sweep up the Chickamauga towards Lee and Gordon's Mill. And as Bushrod Johnson approached Peavine Creek that morning, he receives reports from Confederate cavalry that is indeed screening his front, some of Forrest's men, that a Union force is in their front. Johnson, this contact between Confederate cavalry and Union troops is between one of Minty's patrols that have been sent out, and this contact will force Bushrod Johnson to begin to deploy his troops from the column of march into line of battle, just to the east of Peavine Creek. Now, this first contact that morning of the 18th in the area of Peavine Creek is between some Confederate cavalry and the patrol that Minty had sent out, that mixed patrol of 4th Michigan and 7th Pennsylvania Cavalry soldiers. They were under the command of Captain Heber S. Thompson of the 7th Pennsylvania Cavalry. Thompson is an interesting fellow. He was one of the very first Northerners to volunteer for the defense and preservation of the Union. He was a pre-war member of a Pennsylvania militia company known as the Washington Artillery. And just 3 days after Abraham Lincoln called for 75,000 troops to defend the Union on April the 15th, the Washington Artillery is one of several Pennsylvania companies which are moving by rail from Pennsylvania across Maryland towards the national capital at Washington, D.C. As they pass through Baltimore, they are attacked. Now, some of you all probably quickly said, now wait a minute, the attack on Union troops in Baltimore is April the 19th. Well, yes, that's the one that always gets the attention, the attack on the 6th Massachusetts. But it was the stage for what happened on April 19th was set by the passage of these Pennsylvania militia companies through Baltimore the day before on the 18th. And in particular, it was the passage of the Washington Artillery Company that drew the ire of the mostly Southern sympathizing citizens of Baltimore, because in the ranks of the Washington Artillery was an African-American by the name of Nicholas Biddle, the gentleman in the upper left-hand corner dressed in that pre-war uniform of the Washington Artillery. Spied amongst the ranks of the Washington Artillery, the crowd began to pelt the column with bricks and sticks and other things. The troops were able to get on the trains and on south to Washington. They'll actually be quartered in the United States Capitol, and on the 19th will be visited by Abraham Lincoln himself. They are the first troops to reach Washington for its defense with the beginning of the war, with the firing on Fort Sumter. And these Pennsylvania militiamen will call themselves the first defenders thereafter. And Thompson, many years later in 1910, will write a history of those first militia companies to reach the city. Thompson is not the only first defender in the 7th Pennsylvania Cavalry. The Washington Artillery was mustered in for just 90 days. At the end of their term of service, they go back to Pennsylvania. That unit largely disbands, but almost all of its members rejoin another unit. George Stalen, a lieutenant in another 7th Pennsylvania Cavalry Company, is another one of the first defenders, along with this man, Lieutenant Bernard Riley, who was on September the 18th serving as one of Robert H.G. Minty's staff officers. But it is this patrol of about 100 men from the 4th Michigan Cavalry and 7th Pennsylvania Cavalry that has made contact with Confederate Cavalry and now the advance of Bushrod Johnson's column and forced Johnson to begin to deploy. In that first bit of contact, three members of the patrol will be killed, being the very first men, as their 7th Pennsylvania comrades will say, who are going to be killed in the Battle of Chickamauga. The very first one being John Ward of Thompson's own Company F. Johnson, as he deploys, is going to be joined by Nathan Bedford Forrest himself and a small detachment of Kentucky cavalrymen and Forrest escort. He also will be joined at this point by two batteries of Braxton Bragg's reserve artillery. These two batteries, Havis's Georgia and Barrett's Missouri, are under the command of Felix H. Robertson, and Robertson actually brings those two batteries up to join Johnson's column to thereby provide artillery for these troops who are arriving from Virginia, who at that moment don't have any artillery support. Now, Robertson himself comes along perhaps for another reason, because one of Bushrod Johnson's brigades this day is one of the first of the troops coming from Virginia under James Longstreet. It is the Texas and Arkansas Brigade that had been John Bell Hood's, but which is now commanded by Jerome B. Robertson, the father of Felix H. Robertson. And perhaps Felix had an opportunity to visit his father by bringing those two batteries forward. Both Forrest and Robertson will deploy some of the artillery and open fire on Thompson's patrol. And this contact will cause Minty to push his troops forward over Peavine Ridge to attempt to contest Bushrod Johnson's advance. Johnson, having deployed three brigades forward, will advance forward. He is also going to be aided by Minty's observation of a column. Minty will claim that it is infantry, but it almost certainly has to be cavalry of some sort. But Minty will see a column of dust moving westward off to his left front and towards his left flank. He will call for reinforcements, and this is what will prompt John Thomas Wilder to send him two regiments from Wilder's brigade, which Minty is then going to send on downstream to cover Dyer's ford and Dyer's bridge and screen up as far as the Red House Ford on the Federal Road. But Johnson's deployment is going to cost the Confederates some time, but Johnson will advance this three-brigade formation over Peavine Ridge, pushing Minty's troops back closer towards Reed's Ridge. And in early afternoon, Minty's small brigade, Minty himself will say later that this day it numbered just 973 men. Minty's men are pushed back close to Reed's Bridge. And in early afternoon, Minty deployed his three regiments in a rough semicircle with both the right and left flanks anchored on Chickamauga Creek above and below Reed's, Reed's Bridge. He will attempt to contest Johnson's approach, will actually make a brief forward movement, driving Johnson's skirmish line back over Peavine Ridge for a short time. But when he observes Confederate forces moving to potentially cross Chickamauga Creek upstream and downstream of Reed's Bridge, Minty realizes that any further resistance east of Chickamauga Creek is going to be futile. In preparing to withdraw, Minty orders the two guns of the Chicago Board of Trade Battery to move into a mask or obscured position. Minty says to some shrubs near a ford on Chickamauga Creek. One of the Chicago Board of Trade men say that they moved into the orchard on the Reed farm. The two-gun section of the Chicago Board of Trade Battery is supported by one battalion of the 4th United States Cavalry. And then Minty begins to withdraw the troops or the rest of his cavalrymen over Chickamauga Creek. The first to go will be the other two battalions of the 4th United States Cavalry. They had been deployed in Minty's semicircular position in a rather interesting formation. One of the men will just say that each one of the companies occupied their assigned sector, but instead of being deployed in line, they remained mounted and in column, and column of four, presenting a very narrow front. But because the Confederates are coming over Peavine Ridge in their front, and Peavine Ridge is higher, that all of the men in the company were able to fire by simply firing over the head of the man in front. But Minty will order the 4th United States Cavalry to begin the withdrawal. Minty stations his Assistant Adjutant General, Captain Robert Burns of the 4th Michigan Cavalry, at the bridge itself, because as Minty says, Reed's Bridge was a narrow, frail structure which was planked with loose boards and fence rails. How would you like to ride a horse over a bridge whose floorboards were loose rails or loose boards and fence rails? You know, your horse maybe tips one of those things with its hoof, moves it just enough, and where does another one of the horse's hoof go? Right down through that that opening. Burns is apparently stationed there at the bridge to control the rate of movement over the bridge, so the men are not in too much of a hurry and thereby potentially disturbing the that less than solid surface on the bridge. The bridge is only wide enough for one wagon or two men abreast at a time. So it's going to take some time to move these 900 or so cavalrymen across in pairs over Reed's Bridge. The 4th U.S. Cavalry will go across and begin to redeploy on the west side of the creek, and then the 4th Michigan Cavalry will begin its movement, and then the 7th Pennsylvania Cavalry will go. About the time that the 7th Pennsylvania Cavalry is moving to cross the bridge, Bushrod Johnson's main battle line comes down the western slope of Peabine Ridge and approaches Reed's Bridge and the creek itself. One of the regiments in John Fulton's brigade, the 17th Tennessee, has been taken by Nathan Bedford Forrest on a swing to try to strike at the flank of Minty's line. But the other three regiments of Fulton's brigade, on the right, the 44th Tennessee, in the center, the 25th Tennessee, and on the left, with its left along the Reedsbridge Road, the 23rd Tennessee, these three regiments advanced directly towards Reed's Bridge. Robert Keeble, the commander of the 23rd Tennessee, will write in his report, the left, or my left, resting upon the road running across the bridge, my skirmishers were now hotly engaged with the enemy at the bank of the river, and I was suffering from the effects of the enemy's fire, when all at once, without a command, the regiment with one accord charged the river and bridge at the double quick and put the enemy in flight. The fire from the Federals on the other side of the creek will wound five men in the 23rd Tennessee, including the regimental color bearer, Private Ansel Melton, who was struck in the leg, and as he fell, he will hand the colors off and say, carry them through the thickest of the battle ahead of everything else. Commanding one of the companies in the 23rd Tennessee is William Henry Harder. This is the 4th Michigan 4th Michigan Cavalry Monument, just a little bit to the west of Reed's Bridge, and has a great bas-relief tablet on the front of it depicting the fight at Reed's Bridge itself, or at least as the veterans remembered it many years later. But commanding one of the companies in the 23rd Tennessee is Captain William Henry Harder. A true believer in Southern independence, he has just recently run for and won a seat in the Tennessee legislature. Now, some of you probably say, wait a minute, Tennessee's been occupied, or that Nashville's been occupied by the Federals since February of 1862. But all the terms of Tennessee representatives, the governor, and the legislators, all expire in the fall of 1863. Guess what Tennesseans, Confederate Tennesseans, attempted to do on the first Thursday in August of 1863? Elect new members of the legislature and Confederate Congress. Now, where are Confederate Tennesseans in August of 1863? Almost exclusively in the Army. And so where did this vote really just take place? In the Army. But Harder, depicted here just before the war, had been elected to the legislature to represent his district. He never served. The man elected governor at the time will never be inaugurated either. But Harder has also been making speeches every time the brigade halted in the campaign, keeping the morale of the men up. Harder will write of this rush to the bridge. On arriving near the Chickamauga, the firing ceased and the Federals retired across the bridge, and after forming behind the creek, opened on us with great fury, with grape and small arms, and halted our line. The color bearer of our regiment fell wounded. I seized the flag to carry it, but one of the men volunteered to carry it, so I gave it to him. We charged the lines, but unexpectedly met the creek on our whole front. The bridge was to the left of our wing of our regiment. Before the colonel could order us, I moved my company to the bridge and proceeded to repair it for crossing by replacing the planks the Federals had torn up. This rush forward of the men of the 23rd Tennessee will force the Federals on the other side of the creek to fall back, Some of these Federals were men of the 4th United States Cavalry under Captain Worth Davis, who were trying to throw those loose boards and fence rails off of the bridge. They got that only partly done before this rush of the 23rd Tennessee up to the bridge, put the bridge in Confederate possession and forced the Federals to withdraw a little bit further to the west. The two guns of the Chicago Board of Trade Battery had a little more difficult time getting back across the creek. Positioned in their mask position, they did fire on some Confederates who closed very quickly and appeared suddenly in their front. By one account, there was a little bit of hand-to-hand fighting amongst those Confederates and the 4th U.S. Cavalrymen and the Board of Trade Artillerymen, but the two guns are going to escape across the Chickamauga at a very rough ford, but then are going to be put in back into position on the west side of the creek. And with Minty now having redeployed to the west of the creek, Johnson's men have possession of the bridge, but it first has to be repaired, something that William Henry Carter takes care of. And as he goes on in his account to say, while I was on the bridge, it was splintered by grape shot, the rounds fired from the Chicago Board of Trade Battery. Just as I had the planks laid back down, Forrest came up to me on the bridge on his horse, and with a bright smiling face, placed his hand on my head and said, "You are a brave and gallant captain. What is your name and regiment?" I told him. He rode forward. I cautioned him to be careful. He only laughed and rode forward. I asked him, I asked him if my company must cross. He pointed to where to form my men, and accompanied by an officer, he rode to within 100 yards of the Federals. He halted with his accustomed attentive and intentive manner took in the situation of the whole line of Federals while discharge after discharge of grape and canister dashed by him. Forrest will finish his reconnoitering, turn and ride back towards Reed's Bridge. By this time, Fulton has directed the brigade to cross the creek, and his brigade will cross left in front and redeploy on the north side of the Reed's Bridge Road. McNair's brigade will cross behind him. Gregg's brigade, at least by one participant's account, crosses the creek by fording. But Fulton's men, having redeployed on the west side of the creek, will extend to their right and then sweep westward to try to fall on the left flank of Minty's troop. Minty, having crossed the west side of the creek, redeploys in the area of J. Steen's sawmill and attempted to defend from that position. But with the threat of Confederates crossing the creek upstream and down, Minty is going to have to abandon his position at Reed's Bridge, and he does so by riding out to the Lafayette Road and southward towards Crittenden's left at Lee and Gordon's Mill. As Bushrod Johnson's men are crossing Chickamauga Creek, Johnson is joined by his new superior, John Bell Hood. As you saw in the order earlier, Bragg had put in parentheses Hood's, indicating some awareness that Hood would arrive. And Hood finally has arrived. He had reached the end of the railroad below Ringgold. Had to delete his horse from the train and had then ridden westward to join Johnson's column. Along the way, he will be seen by the men of his old brigade and cheered. He rides westward with his left arm in a sling, still recovering from the wound he received at Gettysburg 2 months before. But now, taking command of this Confederate column, he will order the Confederates to turn southward and sweep up the Chickamauga towards the Union left flank at Lee and Gordon's Mill. This is illustrated here by the red symbols on the map, crossing at Reed's Bridge here near the top and then moving south. But while the Confederates are now successfully across the creek at Reed's Bridge, it is late in the day and too late, but far later than Bragg had envisioned, and too late to launch an assault on the Union left flank that day. And just at dark, this Confederate column is going to be halted by John Thomas Wilder's brigade of mounted infantry, joined now by Minty, just shy of the Lafayette Road. The fight at Reed's Bridge on the 18th has drawn the attention of other Union troops. Just as darkness settles on the battlefield, Minty's reinforcements arrive. Minty's long gone from Reed's Bridge, but the troops sent to reinforce him finally arrive. Dan McCook's brigade of Illinois and Ohio soldiers has reached the area of Reed's Bridge, but as they had approached in the darkness, they make contact with Confederates. Some of the tail end of Hood and Johnson's column turning southward, or even some elements of it returning eastward towards Ringgold. McCook will take possession of some of these Confederates, including the band of McNair's brigade and much of the medical detachment. And it is from this that McCook begins to develop the idea of a lone Confederate brigade somewhere near Reed's Bridge and Jay's Mill, which will be then provided to George Thomas the next morning, and which will have a key influence in the events of September, the morning of September the 19th. On the morning of the 19th, before McCook leaves the area of Jay's Mill and Reed's Bridge, he attempted to burn Reed's Bridge. He sent forward the 69th Ohio with that task. This is the bas-relief tablet on the front of the 69th Ohio's monument, depicting their effort to burn the bridge. And this abortive effort, they will set fire to the bridge, but having stirred up Confederates on the other side of the creek, the 69th Ohio doesn't stay around long enough to see whether or not the fire actually takes. And after the 69th Ohio goes back towards Dan McCook's position, some of those Confederates come up and put the fire out. The 69th Ohio men will mostly go to their graves believing that they burned Reed's Bridge. And if you want to read some humorous accounts in the National Tribune, get all of those where the 69th Ohio guys say, "We burned Reed's Bridge," and Minty's men say, "The bridge was not burned." So it will be a long-standing debate, and I don't know, Dave, how many of those articles there are. There are probably a dozen and a half or something.
Just a dozen.
Yeah, and they're stretched over many years. It was something that periodically came and went.
About every 10 years.
Yeah, recycles through. So, the Reed's Bridge or the Reed's Bridge Road and Reed's Bridge itself will become a key area for the Confederates through the rest of the battle. Several Confederate division and brigade field hospitals will be located along the road, including Benjamin Hardin Helms Brigade Hospital, which is located here at the Reed House. And in fact, it is in this structure that Benjamin Hardin Helms died from the effects of the wound he received on the morning of September the 20th. Enough Confederate hospitals were located out here along Reed's Bridge Road in the area of Reed's Bridge that the Confederates eventually buried 102 men together in one place by a small family cemetery. And Minty's men will eventually try to convince everybody that those are all Confederates they killed in the fighting at Reed's Bridge on September the 18th, which is another interesting little thread that you can follow in the National Tribune. When the National Military Park is created, the veterans originally hoped to include at least the west side of Chickamauga Creek at Reed's Bridge in the National Military Park. But the money appropriated by Congress to purchase the land was not sufficient, and so the area, even the western portion of the Reed's Bridge area, was not included. And so the monuments to Minty's Brigade, here the 7th Pennsylvania Cavalry's monument, being dedicated with 150 former members of the regiment in attendance in 1897. The monuments to Minty's Brigade are just inside the eastern edge of the Chickamauga Battlefield Park today, near Jay's Mill, not on the ground where they were originally intended to be. And in fact, if you have visited there, those three monuments sit at kind of an odd angle to one another, and even to the ground. That's largely because that is a very secondary location for them. Where they originally intended to be located was further to the east and closer to Reed's Bridge. But while the Park Commission was not able to purchase the land at Reed's Bridge itself, they did own for several decades in the first part of the National Military Park's history the road from the Chickamauga Battlefield to Ringgold, part of an approach road system, the major movement routes to the battlefield. And in 1899, the Park Commission built a new bridge to replace the wooden structure that had been there. Here you see the western abutment nearly completed. Here's the eastern abutment under construction. Some of you all who have visited there with me or others, I usually stand on the remains of this eastern abutment. It, of course, not that high today, but here's the bridge that the Park Commission put in. Part of it actually survives as a fence today. This bridge, put up in 1899, was used until 1976, when the concrete and steel structure that is there today was put into place. But while the veterans were unsuccessful in preserving some of the ground of the fight at Reed's Bridge, a preservation effort beginning in the 1990s would eventually bear fruit, with the Civil War Trust acquisition of 107 acres last year. And now, hopefully in the coming year and just in the years right in front of us, we'll see this land open so that you too can walk this ground and consider, as Bushrod Johnson advised us to do, to think about all of the details of this this battle. And the fight at Reed's Bridge is just another one. And perhaps as we draw to a close this evening, we're not at an end, but really at a new beginning. Thank you. Be happy to take any questions. Anyone has any? Yes, sir.
Yes, you spoke earlier of Brown Ferry. Now, that isn't the same Brown Ferry that's in Alabama where that nuclear plant is.
No. Yeah. There are many Brown Ferry, and in fact, just a little bit to the west of Chattanooga on the Tennessee River, there's another
Brown's Ferry. Now, if you don't usually, by the time of the Civil War, that Brown's Ferry is either got another name or it's just not in use any longer. But in regional history in the 1830s, 1820s, this other Brown's Ferry, just a little bit to the west of Chattanooga, it's a real point of confusion, because you'll find some document or a letter which says Brown's Ferry. And are you talking about John Brown's Ferry at Chattanooga, or this other Brown's Ferry just a little bit further to the west? So, and then there is the one in North Alabama that has the nuclear plant at it today.
Are there any plans to move those monuments closer to where they're supposed to be?
Well, that has not been really broached yet. Civil War Trust is just beginning to develop what kind of concept will be will put in place there. I think that's something that should be considered, probably at least in really, you can make a case to do it for all three of them. The Fourth Michigan Calgary Monument one is probably the one that has the strongest case for being located out close to the bridge. That hasn't been broached yet, but I think it is something that would be worthy of consideration down the road. Also, eventually, the 107 acres will come to the National Military Park. But don't hold your breath on that one. We have to have congressional authority to acquire any additional land. You all probably know even better than I the current state of things in Congress. Our chances of getting that legislation passed anytime soon is pretty slim. But that's something that I have wondered, and as I've talked with other people about this, that question has come up. So I think that will be something to consider. So.
Congress is something you prefer not to think about.
Okay.
Since the veterans wanted to place those monuments in their more correct locations, how much information do you have in the files about where those should go?
Yeah, I haven't found a great deal yet, but you know, a lot of those considerations were really with the state monument commissions, and so I think probably need to look even more closely at whatever records survive in Michigan and in Pennsylvania. The Ohio Commission records are very good. But that is something that needs to be investigated. But I think this is part of the Fourth Michigan Monument image. You know, when you think about the bas-relief tablets on the other Michigan monuments on the battlefield, they were all designed to depict a scene that happened on the site where that monument is. And it's pretty clear that these guys had that kind of same idea in mind when they did this. So I think that's another reason why there's a good case for moving this one.
The soldiers recorded at the time of the battle how deep was the water at Reed's Bridge. I know you discussed the drought in your talk, in previous talks. How deep was it? Was it?
I've never seen anybody right at Reed's Bridge give any indication of the depth of the water in the creek at that point. At other places, the water is variously described as being knee to waist deep at the fords. Now, waist deep is too deep for wheeled vehicles to cross. Wheeled vehicles couldn't cross water more than 30 inches. Because that 32 inches, you get into the load-bearing surface of the real deal. But at Thetford's Ford, the water was waist-deep. At Dalton's Ford, about knee-deep or so by the soldier account. Here at Reed's Bridge,
The real issue was the steep banks and how rocky the area is, which meant the number of potential places that you could get into and out of the creek was pretty limited. So it wasn't really the depth of the water or even the width of the creek, it was the steepness of the banks. Well, I do appreciate you all having me up to speak. I really appreciate the honor of the Nevins-Freeman Award. But you all have been great advocates and supporters of battlefield preservation and Civil War scholarship. There are a lot of things out there, Civil War now, that would not be there if it weren't for the good work of the members of the Civil War Roundtable in Chicago over now 75 or so years. That's 737
years.
So, you know, let's see if we can get to 1737. And so keep up the good work. Thank you.